Okay. Yeah, why don't we pray? And today, as we pray, let's just ask the Lord to stir up a hunger for more of Him, and also let's just ask the Lord to move us in the direction of the call that He has for us, for each one of us, and for those of us who have already, know what our life's call is, and already started walking in it. Let's pray that there'll be a fullness into which we step in, more of Him, and a fullness into which we will walk in. That we will mature in that call. That we will go deeper in that call, and on to new things, new seasons. So we can pray on those lines, right? For those of us who are yet to start, saying, okay, I'm just still trying to figure out, or I'm praying and seeking God for what He needs to do in my life or what He wants, you pray as well, saying, God, you show, let there be a stirring, let there be a hunger, let there be a moving towards the things that you have for me, right? So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time that you've given us, Lord. What a privilege it is, Lord, to come to your presence. And this morning, Lord, especially we pray for those of us who are yet to discover our life's calling, Lord, what you have called us to do. And so, God, I pray that that there will be a revelation, that there will be a moving towards it, Father God, today, right now, God. Even as we pray, I pray that eyes will be opened, ears will be opened, O God, to see, to hear. And Lord, I pray that there'll be a revealing, O God, an uncovering, O Father God, in our spirits, Lord, in our heart, what you want, what you want us to do. And I just pray that it'll be a joyful discovery, Lord. Yes, Father God, we thank you. We thank you that you're the one who calls us, you're the one who prepares us, and you're the one who commissions us, Lord. We just thank you, Father God. Thank you for that. Yes, Master. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I pray that that our desire, our hunger for Him will be even more, that whatever is causing that lack of appetite or lack of hunger will be removed, will be taken away, will be totally destroyed, so that, there'll be a genuine, fresh hunger for more of God, for more of His Word, to do more of His will, no matter what the discomfort or no matter what the cost. For some of us, the Lord will direct and say, leave and go, in the sense, just like how He told Peter, and leave your nets and follow me. But for some of us, it'll be to stay in that place, like even how he spoke to the demoniac. He said he wanted to come, but then the Lord says, you stay, you go tell your people. So it'll be either of that. And I just wanted to mention that, because it comes from Him, because it comes from the one who is all knowing, because it comes from the one who knows the end from the beginning, we can receive it, even though sometimes it might be different from what we are aspiring to do, right? We might say, I want to leave this thing, and then go do something new. You might be saying, I want to stay here and then minister. But then the Lord is, leading in a way that's not what we are aspiring to be, aspiring to do maybe. But since it comes from Him, it's all good, right? So just go with it. Just ask the Lord to confirm, ask the Lord to, make things concrete, put it in your heart and give you that sense of peace and go with it, right? Thank you, Lord, Father, Shime, take care. And for those of us, let's just pray for those of us who are already walking in the, in the call of God, and you've taken those steps, you've making those choices, and maybe you're in it for maybe some number of years now. Let's just pray for a deeper walk, a revelation of what needs to be done next, maybe a higher realm, ministering at a higher level, ministering at a realm that that God has for us, and maybe you know, with more of the work of the Spirit, and maybe a new people group being opened, maybe an expansion of the current work, whatever it is, you know, let's just pray and ask the Lord. Father, we pray for that, oh God. We pray for a deeper walk, walk in the higher realm, oh Father God, with you, a ministering of great fruitfulness, oh God. And I just pray, Father God, 2 Corinthians 3, what we've been looking at, oh God, it's a more glorious work of the Spirit. It's a more glorious manifestation of the Spirit. And it's a more glorious ministry. And since it's a ministry of life and not condemnation, God, I pray that for those of us who've been walking in it, oh God, that it'll be a walk in a higher plane, in a higher realm, a close. Walk with you, and a greater manifestation of who you are, God, of let you will draw people to yourself, oh Father God. Yes, Master. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We bless your name. We bless your name. We bless your name. We bless your name. We give you all the praise at this time, and we give you all the glory. In Jesus' matchless name we pray. Amen. 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 Just pray that God will continue to, you know, lead even as we, you know, we know it's a process. We know that, you know, that it's a journey that we make as we walk with God. And yeah, just pray that there'll be a greater revelation and a greater, you know, expansion of the work that you're already doing, that we're already involved in, right? Maybe some of us are saying, I'm too young to start, right? I'm too young to start, or I'm too young to maybe, you know, probably just saying disqualifying. But like Jeremiah, you know, God tells Jeremiah, and he says, you know, do not say that you are too young, right? Well, and then he says, he puts his word in his mouth, in Jeremiah's mouth, and he says, you know, you will do this now. You will establish, you will uproot. He says, you know, do not say I am a youth, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 7. For you shall go to all whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. So do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand, touched my mouth, and said to me, and the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set you over the nations, over the kingdoms, to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. So may the prophetic word be your declaration, be your proclamation. Do not discount yourself saying you are too young. Okay. Maybe some of us are saying, you know, maybe I missed the bus. I'm too old. I'm too, you know, far on in years, and I don't think I can do much. But you know, don't forget that that even with Apostle Paul, you know, he had so many. He was a Pharisee, so he was well into his, you know, he has finished his 30s and whatever. And then there were many years that we do not hear of him, even after he came to the Lord. And so he was probably as, you know, mid 40s by the time, or even older when he started ministering. Right. And so don't worry about your age. Don't worry about, you know, don't discount yourself saying, I wish I had done this in the past or done this in my youth. I wish I had done more. Well, with the time that God has given us, I'm sure that, you know, you can be a blessing wherever you are, and in the and the realm of influence that God gives to you. Right. So, yeah. So don't discount yourself. Just open yourself to God, yield yourself to the Spirit of God, and may the Lord continue to work in and through you. Right? Awesome. Okay. Praise God. Okay. So we've come to chapter 13, which is the practical keys of doing the ministry of the pastor, and after that we will look at you know, the restoration of the ministry of the pastors, and where we will look at some of the lives of some pastors, and it'll, you know, it'll make sense after we have actually studied the practical keys of doing the ministry of the pastor. Okay, so let's just go through this, and as we go through, we get an understanding of you know, the kind of the varied roles that a pastor plays, and also the scope of you know, some of the things that that we might consider to be unspiritual, which are very much a part of the ministry of the pastor. So so it'll give us clarity in that area also, right? Okay, so yeah, so let's look at the first one. First one is to I'm on page 28, and this is chapter 13. Okay, so we're looking at the pastoral ministry, the ministry gift of the pastor, and the you know, generally, you know, these are, let's say the pastor is this person is called to be a pastor, and he or she is ministering in a local church, and these would be the general responsibilities, right? And of course, you know, if somebody is called for a specific functioning, you know, in the local church, like maybe worship or maybe something else, then of course it would vary, right? But we are talking about the general responsibilities. This would be it, right? Okay, so so the first responsibility is of course to keep growing and keep continuing in the journey of prayer and walking in intimacy with the Lord. Okay, and this is very, very, very important, and it's very basic, very foundational. But at the same time, you know, this is something that often has the you know, has the potential to fall by the wayside because of the, you know, many responsibilities, because of the many things that need to be done, and maybe you look at some of the administrative side, maybe some of the other, you know, the ministry side of things. So this would, you know, most likely be the first one to come under attack, either by the enemy or by our own, you know, lack of making it intentional. So, because the thing is, you know, you are anyway doing something Christian, you are anyway preaching, you are anyway praying, testifying, you are engaging with God. But, you know, but so we tend to, and that happens even when we are in Bible college, maybe, you know, attending in-person Bible college more so, we're saying, okay, I am part of this whole thing. You know, we are reading the Bible, and I am part of this prayer, I'm part of this worship. But to seek Him personally and to grow in that intimacy with God, and to grow in that increase in that intimacy in prayer and so on, right? So that's very, very crucial, because out of that flows whatever ministry that we are doing. Okay, it's always an overflow. Public ministry is always an overflow of our private times with the Lord, and it's not the other way around, right? So so it's so very important that we just, you know, if things are getting a little overwhelmed, just, you know, schedule or prioritize and just run to the presence of God and spend time and make it a normal rhythm in life, you know, life and ministry, that this is part of it. This is an undeniable part of it, so that ministry becomes an overflow, right? So so that we know the mind of Christ, and we are ministering out of that place of intimacy, because the Lord does say, you know, without me you can do nothing. John chapter 15, we looked at that He is the vine and we are the branches, and so the fruit comes on the branch, and it's because of the the fruitfulness happens because of the branch being connected to the vine, and out of a place of intimacy that we minister, right? So so what happens is that whatever is done in church, or whatever we pursue as a congregation, as a local church, it is the mind and heart of God, And it reflects it is in the direction where God is leading. And we are not at cross purposes with whatever God is leading. So it comes out of that overflow, right? So this is something that we want to just really place as something that right at the top and say, pray and grow in the relationship with God. Okay. Secondly, we see that a pastor is involved with people. There are all kinds of people, mature, immature, young, old, all kinds of people in the as part of the flock, as part of the church. So all kinds of needs are there as well. So have a process, or be sensitive to the needs and be concerned about the welfare of the families, right? And we know that the welfare of the family could be in either something could be spiritual, it could be a spiritual need, it could be an emotional need, it could be something in the physical, right? So and we know that all three are interconnected as well, right? So spiritual needs, emotional needs, material needs, that these are taken care of, right? Or we have something in place to take care of that, right? To find, if it is a big gathering, like if it's a small gathering, yes, it's just even then it's sometimes difficult, right? When people do not share the pain that they're going through, the struggles that they're going through, etc. So it's it's good that even in a small gathering we have a formal process in place, some number to reach out to, some person to reach out to, if they are going through some kind of difficulties, right? So in the spiritual realm, so which means that they are fed spiritually, right? That there is the ministry of the word, there is that there is that push or invitation to draw people to feed from the word, both corporately as well as individually, right? That constant encouragement, that constant push of the people in the church to be able to stand, to be able to stand on their own, to be able to to have those disciplines in place, like worship and word and prayer and so on, right? So to create avenues for people to learn in different ways, right? Maybe Sunday sermon, it's messages which are probably kept somewhere so that they have access to it, or something that's on a daily ongoing basis, something inspirational, something that people can have access to, right? To encourage them to move in that direction, and also to have small groups or accountability, some kind of accountability where people can sharpen one another, encourage one another, and then grow, not only in the call of God, but also in these very things, right? So spiritually, like emotionally as well, right? Emotionally, that people thrive when it comes to the soulish realm of mind and will and emotions, and if you look at 3 John in verse 2, where I think we've seen this over and over again, and we looked at in the financial stewardship class, 3 John in verse 2, beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. So we take care of the realm of the spirit, prayer and worship and word and so on, but also the realm of the soul, when it comes to emotional health or mental health and oppression, how to deal with it. So it's, again, we know it's interconnected, right? So to deal with that aspect, to teach on that, and so people can thrive emotionally as well. Right? People are equipped to deal with maybe, you know, negative thoughts or oppressive thoughts or things that happen in the, you know, in the thought, in their thought life. You know, maybe strongholds, how to deal with that, etc. So, and to have avenues where if people are in some kind of a problem, you know, in these areas, like maybe a counseling counseling ministry, or maybe even a reference to something on that line, right? So where people know where to get help. Okay, people don't have to suffer in silence, and of course, sharing from time to time when we're addressing the gathering also helps. I don't even remove those stigma and shame and everything, and say, okay, you know, this is something that has to be dealt with and can be dealt with, and the Lord died on the cross to give us victory in these areas as well. And it's not something that we need to suffer in silence, but we can find victory, right, in these areas. So so the people can reach out, and also this pastor may not have all the resources. We need to understand that, you know, the pastor may not have all the resources, may not be an expert in that particular field, but the pastor can always refer, connect people. Okay, so just saying that to think about these areas and to see if people are doing well, right? And not to kind of downplay that, right? And physically, because material needs, people need to be taught how to handle finances, people need to be taught, with regard to spending, saving, and making good choices when it comes to finances, and also about their health and so on. So as a pastor, you know, we facilitate that, you teach that, and to ensure that people, if they are in any kind of problem, they can always reach out. Right? So in a way, you know, you're taking care of the flock of God, right, in all these areas, spiritually, emotionally, and physically. But also, you know where the line is, where you don't get overly involved, that one is making the decisions for them. Right? We need to be careful. Also, you know, overly attached, that it becomes like a controlling thing, you know, all that. I'm sure you know you must be learning in Kingdom Builders and other courses about this, and of course, right, in Ministers Foundations, you know, you would have gone through it. So it's that again, you know, it's very, very important, right? But it covers this, that we look at, we are sensitive to, we are aware of all these kinds of challenges or these kinds of needs in the lives of people whom we are shepherding, right? Whom the pastor is called to shepherd. Okay. Vision for the church. Now that probably, you know, that's the first thing, which after intimacy with God and having all those strength things in a, and all those disciplines in place, this would be the first thing, right? What is the vision? What has God called the church to be, right? Or what is God's blueprint for this particular church or this particular group of people to whom you, God has placed in the midst to give a spiritual leadership, right? What is the vision? And so that is very, very important for us as pastors to understand, to seek God's face, to really know and understand, God, what is the vision for this ministry, or what is your heart for this church? Okay, so vision is big picture, right? Vision just means to see. In plain English, it just means to see. But really, when we say vision, it is Let me just put it here. It's so vision for ministry, vision for church. It's a description about what the church will do or what the church will become. Okay, so it's also that statement, that vision statement, will also communicate purpose, you know, the reason for our existence, focus on the future. What are we, you know, what are we looking at? What are we aiming for? And also be a call to action. You know, this is what we're aiming for. So therefore, gather around. You know, therefore, let's go. Let's do this together. Right. So the vision statement should really communicate that. But as a pastor, or maybe you're the lead pastor, you're the one who's planting the church, a lead pastor, or maybe you're the pastor of a particular ministry in church. Right. So clarity about vision is very, very important, and clarity about where, you know, what is the church about? What is this ministry about? And what are we called to do? Where are we going? And to get that clarity. So if we are under or working with a senior pastor, you know, to really have that dialogue and receive that blueprint, right? To receive that vision, okay. So pastor, what is it? You know, yes, I'm taking care of this ministry, I'm taking care of this, but you know, what is God, what has God put in your heart, you know, for this particular ministry or for this particular function, ministry function in the local church? What is it to get, you know, so the reason is God actually puts the blueprint, right? So the primary, because he is the primary vision holder, right? God has given that vision. And yes, God will, you know, as a ministry leader, God will give certain things to you as well to discuss that and to you know, come to an agreement. Okay, this is where we will go. Okay, so it should not be something that is very different from what the, you know, the lead pastor or the senior pastor is looking at, or you know, then there will be unnecessary tension, conflict, and we're not going in that direction. So you know, coming to an agreement and say, okay, this is the big picture, this is where we are heading. Okay, now vision is very important because it flows from the pastor and on to the people whom the pastor is called to, you know, give oversight to God's people, right? To give oversight so that you know, everybody's moving in the same direction, right? So to really look at church that way, right? To look at church and say, okay, yeah, we're not here to just conduct services. You know, that's a very small vision. If it's only about gathering on Sundays, and you know, if it's just to study the Word of God, we sing a few songs, we encounter the presence of God, and then we go back. Now, you know, that's hardly you know, that's a small part. But to really see God's heart and say, okay, God, you know, we know that church is the body of Christ, and as a local church, there is something. There is a plan that you have for this territory and for this place. It could be big, it could be a nation, it could be a, you know, just maybe a few streets, but whatever it is, God, you know, whatever you've called us to do in this region, give us a plan, give us a blueprint. And so the pastor receives that, you know, receives those strategies, receives that blueprint. And it, yes, it comes as a burden. It comes as, you know, as a desire to do, okay, I want to do this. We want to do this. And to get God's heart, get God's burden for, you know, for that particular maybe people group or that territory, geographical region, and to pursue that. Okay, so before so there could be three questions, right? I'm just spending a bit of time on vision. You will be looking at it in later courses also, yeah, so it'll be a kind of reminder. So the thing is, okay, what, you know, addresses three questions. Okay, what do you want to do? Okay, that will describe the vision, and why, you know, describes our mission and principles and values. Just mentioning this, we won't go into details. How, you know, determines our goals, objectives, activities, right? So to have a clear vision, Proverbs 29 and verse 18, it says that where there is no revelation or where there is no vision, what happens is people cast off restraint, but happy is he who keeps the law. I mean, there is no clarity of vision, then there are no boundaries, and people cast off constraints in the sense they're free to go, you know, wherever, whichever, in terms of effort, in terms of direction, but we're not going together, right, as a body, whom God has called. So when there is a clarity of vision, then there is clarity of purpose. Okay. So when there's clarity of purpose, then our thoughts, actions, efforts go in that direction, because there is clarity of direction as well. Okay, this is what we need to do. This is what we are doing, and so let's go for it. So it could be many diverse things, right? It's not just one thing that the local church is going up. It could be diverse ministries, diverse activities, like we see in 1 Corinthians 12. You know, diverse ministries, different kinds of activities, but the same spirit. God will call a leadership and a local church, and give that vision and say, okay, I need you to do this. I need you to be this in this place, right? So when we have that clarity, then there is clear action, clear, pulling in of resources, effort, and there's direction, and there's movement, right? You're moving towards it. So for us to understand that, let me just put this. So clear vision provides direction and guidance. Okay. This is applicable to us personally as well, okay, and not just corporately, personal. So a clear vision provides direction, provides guidance. It also brings light, in the sense there is clarity. It brings light. There's clarity. And thirdly, our responsibility, as pastors, is to state that vision. Okay, is to really spell it out, to state it, and so that there is a statement of that vision, which can be communicated. Okay, so when you receive the vision, okay, this is what God. It could be small, big, whatever, but we know that we can ask God for a big vision, because he has the whole world, and he's a savior of the whole world. So we can ask God for a big vision, but the thing is, he has also, he has plans, purposes, he has gifted us in certain ways. So we go with whatever clarity we receive, and we state it, right? Make a statement of it. We see in this verse, maybe you've read this, Habakkuk 2 and verse 2. Habakkuk 2 and verse 2. Says, the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. Okay, so maybe we can just go there for a minute, Habakkuk chapter 2. It's interesting how the Lord instructs Habakkuk. Okay, Habakkuk chapter 2, okay, verse 1, Habakkuk says, I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me and what I will answer when I am corrected. So he's positioning himself, right? He's waiting on God. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but the end of it will speak, it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. Right? So one practical takeaway is that the Lord is saying, you write it on tablets, make it plain, make it simple, so that one who reads it, runs, meaning is move to action. Right? So make it plain, write it down, meaning you know, you need to you can communicate it, you can show it to others and make it simple so that the one who reads is moved to action. Okay, so which leads us to the fourth thing. That's right, Charles. The fourth one that we see is which we need to do as, and which we're responsible for as pastors, is to communicate that vision. Now the vision could be, you know, locked up in our heart, it's in our mind, you know, as one person, as the vision carrier, as the vision bearer, but we really need to communicate that, share that, make it common with the people to whom we are leading, right? And unless we share it, they will also, once we share it, they put their shoulders to the work, right? And say, okay, this is something that God has spoken to us, right? And when you communicate the vision, others who are not part of that vision, you know, they are also drawn to the vision and say, this is what God has actually spoken to us. And we want to be part of this work. We want to be part of what God is doing. You know, we are excited to be part of what God is doing. And this is what God wants us to do. And we will do it. So communicate the importance of communicating the vision. Right. So it helps us, well, first of all, to really know what it is, to help others know what it is and then be part of the vision. It also helps us to it also helps us in many ways. It gives us direction, it brings in that enthusiasm, it brings in that that motivation, and then you're part of that work, right? So we communicate the vision, and that responsibility is up to us, you know, as the spiritual leaders of, you know, maybe you're a ministry leader, you communicate the vision, right? You're the primary, you know, to use the word vision caster, right? You're casting the vision, you're saying, hey, you know, God has called us to do this, right? And it's not something that I'm pursuing alone, but God has called us together as a church, as a body to do this. Okay, so we communicate it in a manner that's simple, clear, easy to understand. You know, sometimes what happens is when it comes to visions, you know, it's a grand plan, and make it very complex, so people are finding it very difficult to understand what it is. Right? So make it simple, make it plain, put it there on as many as many vehicles as possible, avenues as possible, so people can, you know, see it, hear it, watch it, get that vision ingrained, okay, in their lives. Okay, the thing is that all of us, we have the ability to remember. We also have the ability to forget. So reiterate, you know, repeat the vision, whenever possible. Okay, you decide, okay, this is a good time to do this, but you repeat the vision. And of course, you know, here at All People's Church, we have the vision repeated every time the church gathers for worship on Sundays. So it's part of the church announcement, it goes there. So this is the vision. So people get to hear it, and sometimes people switch off also, but we just need to do it in interesting ways, so people hear it, understand it. They may have questions. Okay, what is this? You know, we have this membership class for people who want to become members, right? So there we talk about the vision. You know, talk about the vision. What is it that we want to do? What does it mean to be salt? What does it mean to be light? And what does it mean to be the voice? So we talk about that. So repeat the vision. It helps to communicate it over and over again, and not to the point of tiring the people, but really so that it is reiterated. Okay, like for example, we had a for the worship team, right, for the worship ministry, we have a vision statement. Okay, so every time the church, or the worship team meets, we make it a point to, kind of explain it, talk about it in creative ways. We just try to see. Okay, so the last time we met, we had a something like a quiz kind of thing, like a fill in the blank. So it was online, of course, so we could do this. Let me just put it up for you. Okay, right, so shift, oops. Okay, so I think you can see, so everyone in the team during the orientation, we kind of make it a point for them to understand or state the vision, understand it, etc. So AMI's worship ministry, the big picture. So we just put it up. The vision of APC's worship ministry is to, so people had to, type it on the chat. What is that? And then, okay, you have the answer. And then, put it up. Again, people need to chat. Either unmute and say what the blank is, or they need to put it in the chat. Yeah, so that is it, right? That's the vision. The vision of ABC's worship ministry is to please God's heart in unrestrained worship, to encounter his manifest presence, and to establish a community of believers who will do the same. Okay, so the vision of the worship ministry is not to lead people in worship. That's not the first thing. Okay, so this is the order in which it comes to, is actually to please God's heart in unrestrained worship, which means that I personally, as a believer, as a worshiper, I posture myself to please God's heart in unrestrained worship. It's unrestrained worship because I don't want to hold anything back. Secondly, to encounter his manifest presence. So it's not just a time of singing some nice songs or playing some good music, but it's really about the presence of God, right? So to encounter his manifest presence. And thirdly, the third part of the vision is to establish a community of believers. So I do this personally, I do this as a ministry team, and then it overflows, right? So intentionally we do things to establish, so which is the ministry part of it, which is what happens on maybe Sundays, or maybe we teach on worship when there's a when there's an opportunity to do that, and so on. Okay, let me just come back. Okay, so you can do it in creative ways. You don't have to always, read it out, but you can do it in creative ways. And but it's important that the vision is repeated, so people get a hold of it, right? So it remains in people. I think it was Bill Hybels who made this statement in a leadership conference. I don't know. He said, "Vision leaks." And the picture that he explained it by giving us a picture saying, let's say you have a bucket, and the bucket is punched full of small holes, and you fill the bucket, right? And what happens is, over a period of time, the water leaks, water starts to leak. These are small, minute holes, but still it leaks. And over a period of time, you notice that the bucket is empty, right? And you need to refill it. And so also, if you look at it, that's what happens. If the vision is not reiterated, repeated, people have many things, and it's, get into the details of the work or the task and forget what the big picture is, right? So the importance of repeating, reiterating the vision. Okay. On the same lines, the pastor also oversees the preaching and teaching or ministry of the Word of God. Okay, to oversee the preaching and teaching and ministry of the Word of God. Now, God's Word is powerful. We know God's Word is transformative. It's living. Hebrews 4:12 talks about all that. And so it's important that it's handled with care. It's important that it's ministered, it is shared in a manner that rightly divided and with the right emphasis of the word and the spirit, and it's so that it brings change in people's life. I mean, the Holy Spirit really transforms people's lives, and people experience the truth, and not really brought under any kind of bondage or any kind of legalistic weight of things, but rather it's freedom, like liberty. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is liberty, right? And this Holy Spirit, it's all about the ministry of the Spirit. Ministry is all about opening of prison doors, right? And the Lord Jesus himself states that, I've been anointed to do this, the opening of prison doors to those who are in prison, the opening of blind eyes to see the truth, and so on. So it's a very liberating ministry is liberating. The word of God is very, very liberating, freedom, right? So when done in the right manner, doesn't bring people into bondage or guilt or shame or condemnation. It's very liberating. So therefore, the lead pastor is responsible for the preaching and teaching of God's word. Responsible for the oversight. Give oversight to the preaching and teaching. Set the direction. Just like how he's the primary vision caster. So also with regard to the preaching and teaching of God's word. And the scriptures that we looked at in previous classes, when it came to the roles and rewards, responsibilities and rewards of the pastor, we looked at 1 Timothy, we looked at 2 Timothy, we looked at Titus, and Paul writing to Timothy, and you notice how he talks about he's charging Timothy. Let's just read that. 1 Timothy and the very first chapter, verse 3, is, as I urged you when I went into Macedonia, remain in Ephesus that you may charge some. Now, Timothy, that you may charge some that they teach no other doctrine. Nor give heed to fables and endless genealogies which cause disputes rather than godly edification. Since the objective is godly edification, since the objective is is this, that there is right doctrine, right teaching, and so on. So Paul is saying, I charge you that I asked you to remain there, and that you may charge some, that you may command, that you may, very firmly instruct some that they teach no other doctrine, right? So, which means what he's meaning is that now, Timothy, you be in charge of that. You give oversight to that. You be careful of what is being taught. Guide them. It need not be done in a very in a very military fashion. It can be done in a very nurturing manner, so that that oversight, you're able to give people the freedom, delegate and give people the freedom, and there is that guidance. You've already kind of set the direction, set the thing, and maybe there is a process of correction, etc., when things go a little bit off, but he is in charge now. Right. So, and he says over and over again, right? Even in chapter 4, he talks about that. Be an example, but give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine, etc. Right. So the importance of that. So as a pastor, be careful of what is being shared from the pulpit. First of all, you hold yourself accountable. And the thing is, whom you place there. Okay, on the pulpit or at the podium to minister to the flock of God, right, whom God has put you as an overseer. So you be careful. Who are you inviting? Who are you placing? Right. Just be mindful of that. Right. It's just that. Be discerning, because it's going to have far-reaching you know, consequences. If somebody comes and shares something which destroys the lives of people, then they might come and go, but you know, it is you as a lead pastor who's going to be left with the damage. So you need to, you know, work on the repair, on the maintenance, right? Okay, so we'll stop here, take a break, and then get back. Okay.